Well, I'm here with Mr. Phil Bolton at Moona Links Golf Course, the original home for the Australian Golf Union, wasn't it, for Australia?
Yeah, Golf Australia.
Golf Australia. Mm. And you're the head teaching professional here?
At the Moona Links Golf Academy, yes.
At the Moona Links Golf Academy. Now, you've got a fantastic facility there. It was initially designed for the Australian Institute of Sport.
Correct.
And they were here for a number of years. Mm. And you're basically, that's your home.
Yes, and I love it. It's great coming here every day. It's a really great place to be. It really is.
Home away from home.
Indeed.
Anyway, we're out here on the main course. What do they call this course?
The Open Course.
This is because they had the Australian Open here.
Yeah, and that's why it's Peter Thompson named it. It was built specifically for the Australian Open. And it's got that Thompson signature for sure with the fairway bunkers. And you really have to think your way around this golf course because there are a lot of bunkers out here. And unless you really have some aim points when you stand up on a tee and know where you're going to, those bunkers are very deep and they're very penal. And a lot of the times here, it's go out sideways or even backwards.
Yep.
So we have our aim points here. Pick our yardage on this particular hole here. I aim up, it's 446 metres long. The fairway bunkers are very inviting and say come over this way to take a shortcut. But into this wind today, I prefer to hit up the last house there on the left. There's a bush just to the right of that, and I certainly aim it there all the time because even if it goes into light rough here, it gives me a terrific angle from the next shot into the throat of the next hole.
So this course really is all about strategy, and you're going to help us get our way around here today.
Well, that's the idea. If you can get your way around this course without going in the fairway bunkers, you really are going to keep your score down. There's no doubt about that. You'll have a much lower score rather than going in those fairway bunkers.
Well, Phil, you lead us off, mate.
Thank you, Peter.
I'll follow your lead. Just done it perfect. It's just going to miss it.
No.
Oh.
Just got it.
Wait, that's
best
the
laid plans.
Yeah. Look, the trouble is when you mention all of these things, your mind doesn't know. It has a no-no button, does it? So definitely. What I noticed is there was quite a bit of breeze. You had a nice shot there. It just didn't draw like it would normally.
I normally did.
The wind's coming that way, so.
That's okay.
It's okay. I'm going to go a little bit further left. I'm going to take your idea on.
Pretty much perfect, Peter. It might just land the light rough, but it'll be a very, very safe shot for your next. Usually they kick down off the hill there, but it's not too bad.
Well, I thought your advice might be very good, so I tried it. Now, Phil, we've got a young guy with us here today. This guy's he's been playing golf about 6 months.
Okay.
And I'd really like you to keep an eye on him for me. Just make sure if you find anything that you can help us with, he's really enthusiastic. And Jake Hauer.
Yep.
We're back playing on these fantastic golf courses.
Yes.
You like this one?
This is my home, so I do like this one.
Excellent. Wow. Mate, look how far he hits that, Phil. Hey, how would you like to hit it like that, eh?
I think I might have to adjust the lines I give him, Peter. I think I might give him a little bit tighter lines.
I think he goes across that bunker with
high
these.
Power. He can go straight over the top. I've no doubt about that at all.
Anyway, 6 months. He's a six-month-old golfer. He's a baby golfer.
He is, and that's what happens. They start young, and they're fresh, and they hit it miles, and all we're going to do is straighten them up. When they've got that power, it's great.
Okay, let's go and play the next shot.
Okay, well here I am, hit another ball off the tee, and I've just managed to miss the bunker this time. And as you can see up there, there's another seven bunkers we're going to try and avoid up on the fairway. So again, rather than try and take those bunkers on, I'm going to aim well left of them. There's another bush up there. fact, I look above the bush and I see a gum tree on the horizon. So I like to look high and have an aim point high.
Yep.
So I'm going to aim up towards that gum tree now, knowing we're going back into the wind, and I'll try and get it have. I'm going to get 3 wood, have about 100 metre shot out.
Super shot, mate. That's position A. That was, I like to do that one.
Just takes the bunkers completely out of play and allows you to set up on the hole, have a clear shot in from a third shot.
Tell you what, it's a great hole, isn't it?
Yeah, it's got everything.
It's you know, the third shot in, the green set up there. It's all, overall, it's a really nice par five.
And it's usually played into prevailing southerly wind where we're going to today. So it's not an easy hole, but it's a hole, if you think about the hole, you can actually make your birdie, certainly your par, just by positional play.
Well, Jake, I tell you what, you ran through the fairway up into the rough here and you got your hybrid. I'd really like Phil to maybe give you some strategy or advice as to what sort of shot to play here, because it's important, isn't it? Otherwise you can make a big number.
Yeah, I think it's in this particular case, because the fairway is fairly, the rough's fairly wispy there, it's not going to affect the club coming into the ball that much. However, you look at how far the first bunker is there, and I'd say that's probably, 150, 160 metres away?
Yep.
Would you say? And then you're looking at about 180 for the next. Now, how far do you hit that club?
The flat lie, it's probably 220.
Okay, so you're going to bring those bunkers into play. So what you'll have to do here out of this lie is hit it left of those bunkers, which means you've got a very narrow area here.
Yep.
Now, what I'd be looking at doing from there, how far do you hit your 7-iron?
160.
Okay, so that's going to be short of that bunker, isn't it?
Yep.
And then if you do hit your 7-iron well, then you'll only have about a 7 or 8 on the green. Now, if you hit this hybrid well, number one, you could bring the bunkers into play. It could smother into the rough there, and then you're still going to have 80 or 98 anyway. So just a strategy point of view, and this is where it's a good tip for young players. Think of the next shot.
Sure.
Think of the score you're going to have in the hole, and as Peter said, we don't want to run a big number up. There's no great, if you could stay in here and say, well, I can knock this on and make the putt and make birdie, that'd be fine.
Yeah.
But we'd need a bazooka to get it there from here. So let's try that strategy and go 7-iron, 7-iron and see how you finish up on the hole.
Isn't that the way? So, you know, as we all would like to have the ultimate, but you got to play smart golf.
Yeah, it's a downhill lie, ball's below your feet. Very easy for the club to hit the ground early before the ball. Whereas with the loft of something like a 7-iron, set up to the ball with the club face slightly open, because the long grass might pull the club face closed a little. And even if you do happen to hit it to the right of that bunkie, again, you're still only going to be at 130, 140 metres out from the green.
Right, put that into action.
I would always make sure I had a practice swing almost on the parallel line next to the ball, not too close so we don't move the grass, but at least get the feel where the bottoming out of the arc is. We've got to feel where that ball is at the bottom of the arc. Okay, now see how that was a little high there? I want you to really feel you can get that club down to the ground. That was great. Good swing. That's a terrific golf shot.
How good a shot is that? Hey.
Really good strategy, terrific shot. And that would have been just short of the bunker.
Perfect.
Great shot,
beautiful.
Well played. Very
Thanks
well done.
Thanks for the advice.
All right, Pete, we've got you just run through the fairway.
That's I'm up here now. My situation, I'm going to be aiming out to the left, and I can certainly carry over the first bunker, and I won't get to the second lot.
I think the third bunker up on the left there where the magpies are, it's about 185, 190 metres into the wind. So the further up you can get up that left side, as I said, even if you do happen to be in the light rough, you have a really, really good angle to that green up there. So you're playing a 3-wood there, Peter?
I play a 3-wood, and that's exactly what I say. Aim where you're saying, right.
Excellent.
Up there on the...
Terrific.
I got 3 birdies if I get those ones.
Indeed. And no damage done. The ball's below your feet, as we could see there, so it wasn't an easy shot. But I think it's worth having a go with the 3-wood off that lie. The alternative was to go back to an eye, but I think that's a good play playing the 3-wood.
Yeah, no, margin error was there. Yeah. And, you know, I'd certainly like to have hit it better, but the lie was a bit tough off that downhill lie.
Indeed.
So, Jake, I tell you what, that was great advice, Phil, you gave him there. Mm. Look, he's just short of the bunker. And these bunkers are deep. You wouldn't want to get in them, would you?
Well, you're not going to get to the green from them unless you're a world-class player, and that's the thing. And even hitting anywhere from 80, 90, 100, or about 130 metres out into the green with the amount of spin you're going to get on the golf ball. And we've been, Jake and I were just talking about this hole here. You can feel the wind getting up there a bit now. And my philosophy is the front half of the green has almost a false front. So what happens when you get on the green, if you get any sort of juice into the wind, it's going to come back down and can be up to 50 metres short. So it's good to go the extra club, and then you won't have to jump all over it. Take a bit of the spin off it, and I think you'll find that this will work out pretty well.
The other thing is, while we're just here, the strategy on this golf course, which Peter Thompson and Mike Wolveridge designed, this fairway bunker here for the third shot, you've still got a big carry to carry over these next lot of bunkers, haven't you? So the idea is a good smart play. Keep out of the bunkers.
Very much so.
Yeah. Okay, Jake, show us what club you got here, buddy.
Six.
Six iron, okay. And how far have you got?
160 yards.
160 yards, okay. Well,
I'm glad to see someone else talks in yards, Peter. They're not all our vintage. It's nice to see the young blokes talking in yards. There's obviously got aspirations to play in the
Well, Jake's getting organised. You know, he's hunting scratch. He wants to get to the American side of the world.
Oh, yeah.
Good, very good.
Oh, that's beginner golfer. So that's no problem. You hit a fantastic shot. You can do it again.
That's why golf's such a great game when you're having a social round. It's not about scoring.
Now just a second, Jake.
Enjoy the golf course and learning.
Just a second. So you drop that ball down. Let's just play as if you're playing in a tournament.
Yep.
Pick the ball up. You're not allowed to do that. You're gonna play this as a provisional ball for a lost ball.
Yep.
Okay. So you hold it up approximately where and just behind where you were with the last shot.
Yep.
And just drop it down. You might as well practice the way you're going to play with the scorecards in your hand. Well,
I saw that one,
so that'd be fine. We'll get a pitch and a putt. So what do you think about that, Phil, with that situation? Do you think, Jake, if he's played that shot, what would you suggest he needs to do to play a better shot than that?
I think as Jake plays more golf, he'll realise that everything doesn't have to be at 100%. Can back it off to about 85% just to work on your rhythm. That's all I'll be working on with you. Technique's pretty good, but I'd like to work on that rhythm. So getting it all smoother.
Yeah.
There. You know, just such a nice, smooth rhythm.
Yep.
Yeah, rather than have the big muscles turned on all the time. So when you're shooting a green like this, and shooting basically means that as Peter takes aim with the laser, he takes a reading from the top of the pin. And in this case, what's your reading there, Peter? How many yards, or do you talk metres?
I'm 129 yards.
Okay, to the top of the pin.
The top of the pin.
And your factor, it's very slightly uphill, maybe 3 or 4 degrees of slope up there.
Yeah, I think probably 135 yards.
135 yards,
yeah, and then the breeze is worth another 10, about 140, 145
so
yards.
So is that a 7 or 8 iron for you, Peter?
I'd probably play just a solid 7.
Good, good.
Eight, like you said, rather than jump all over an 8, I'd rather hit a solid 7, and of course, as you said, the false front of the green, it's much better to be up there. pushed it a little bit.
Should be on the green now comfortably. It's on the flat level of the green. At least by having the extra club, it made you get up to the top edge of the green, which is good. I'm going to go and play my club shot with the same club because I feel that breeze has got up a little bit more. Even though I'm just a few metres in front, I still think it's the right club.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Now, Phil, before you spoke about picking a target well above...
Yes.
Why is that?
Good question, Jack. What I like to do, rather than look low and look at the pin only, I'm looking up above the pin. I'm trying to hit my picture the ball flight.
Yep.
So I'm imagining it's a big circle up above the pin and a bit left of the pin in the sky, and I'm trying to hit my ball through that circle. So I'm actually really trying to hit my ball up, and I'm thinking of the trajectory the ball's going to go on. And I've got a 7-iron here. In fact, I'm looking at the yellow tree behind the hole. Going to hit the ball high above that.
And a beautiful shot it is. Perfect.
That should be comfortably on the green, well away from the false front.
Yeah, and nice sweet hit. You didn't force it either. I noticed that.
Didn't try and force it and try to work on balance, have a balanced finish. And that's something, Jake, you'll get to as well when you learn to just use maybe a 3-chord or not actually your full power, and you'll have much better balance after you hit the shot.
Well, Phil, we found Jake here just on the edge of the trouble. So what?
Jake, you notice how that club's getting impeded a little.
Yep.
Don't be afraid to go down the bottom of the grip. Yeah, really right shorten down. It down, and you'll find the push isn't going to get in your way anywhere as much. And once again, how much swing are you going to need here to get it? You're only going to fly the ball about 20 metres. You certainly don't have to fly it to the pin.
No.
If you can fly it 20 metres, you'll get the downslope. It'll run on the middle of the green somewhere. And I just think that's what should be your thought process. Maybe 25 metres you need to hit the ball.
Yep.
So how much swing do you need to do that? Good. Focus on the shot, trust your shot, and complete. Okay, now just stay there. What I'd like to do is when you play those shots, when you actually hit the shot, hold your finish and say, right, did I really practice to go that far?
Yeah.
So then the more you play the shot, the more you do it, the more you'll realise the backswing and the follow through on the practice has to marry up, because you've actually thought process was very good and just a matter of execution. I like on these particular shots, because I want control, I like to play it with my back foot flat on the ground. No need to come up with this shot. If you can look at your golf game and think, well, I don't lift my feet with my putting because I want control. So with this shot, I'd like to see you have a little practice and just play the shot with your foot, your back foot down on the ground, even after you've hit the ball. Let's just see if we can get a little bit more control. So try your backswing and your forward through. See how the foot wants to come up?
Yeah.
Okay. Now keep it, even then, it's not allowed to come up at all. Practice, no. Keep the back foot down. It's a tough one to get, but once you get it, you'll really start to compress the ball nicely at the bottom of your arc. Keep that back foot down. It wants to come up, doesn't it?
It does.
Really does.
Tell you what, it comes up with his head. So if he kept his head down as well, it might...
Yeah, I just think it's stability is the big thing I like to work with my students. Really keeping compact and downstairs really quiet, so the arms then control how far the ball goes. That makes sense to you, Jake?
Yep.
Good man. Let's see if you can hit this with your back foot flat on the ground and control the length of the backswing and follow through. Stay there. Now that was with your back foot flat on the ground. Now it was a much better shot because it wasn't as active. You can imagine what happens when the club stays low and you stay low with it. You'll have so much more control. See how it wants to come up there?
Yep.
Okay, good. And there's so much more control of your backswing and your forward through. So instead of thinking about it being a mini golf swing, just think about it being a specialist shot. Just that specialist shot. You'll get really good at it.
Cheers.
Well done. Okay, Jake, so let's see what you learned there. You found the spot where you want to hit it to. Now, obviously, with what we just spoke about, keeping the feet quiet, you can see why you're doing that.
Yep.
You just want the control of your backswing and your forward through. And I'd say you're probably going to try and land the ball up here somewhere. Would that make sense to you?
I've got a 52. I'm just going to put a bit more left under it, I think.
What club have you gone to?
I went to a 60, actually.
Okay, good. So landing it somewhere up around here would be a good mark. So you only have to hit the ball about 10 or 12 yards to land it there. So obviously we don't need any foot action going at all. We just want to control the club head back and through so it's nice and low. It's a nice lag on the shaft. I like that technique. Much quieter downstairs. That's a terrific shot. How's that back foot looking?
Go in. Oh, boy.
Is it up or is it down?
Rose, as I looked through the shot, that was
but,
down.
But have a look. It hit the pin and really? Bounced back. Yeah, hit
wow,
the pin.
What a shot. Great shot. Well done.
Lucky the pin was there. It would have gone 3 foot past. Great shot from that distance, wasn't it?
Excellent.
Good lesson, Phil. He's a pretty quick study, this boy.
He picks it up very, very quickly. Now the trick with these greens around here is always look from both sides so you get an idea and you feel it in your feet as you're walking down. You know, it's a lot of the players these days, Adam Scott et al, they're all using Aimpoint or Aimpoint Plus where they're feeling the slopes of their feet. I don't quite go to that standard, but what I'm actually doing here is looking at this putt. I can see the green falls that way, so I'm going to aim the left edge of the hole. It's a little bit down breeze, which is pushing it that way, so I'm going to aim left edge. I'm going to be quite cautious with this putt. I've had it before, I know how fast it is. So I'm going to aim just left of the hole. You notice my practice stroke isn't too long. So I'm trying to replicate when I play the putt with my practice stroke. And you notice very much so when after I hit it, I actually hold the finish and you see that ball rolling down towards the hole. And I'm not disappointed in that. And I've still held the finish there when I finish the putt off. So I've tried to hit it left, hold the finish, stay low and don't move.
Okie dokie.
Happy to have a 1 foot putt from a par today.
Very good. Well, I got a little bit longer putt than Phil, and but so he's made his par, and I'm uphill. I can see like he's just, we're uphill, and I'm uphill, and the slope's right to left.
Peter, don't forget to factor the wind into play. You are coming into the wind as well.
Okay.
The peninsula down here, we have a lot of wind. And it can affect the ball up to a metre and a half on a putt like this. So factor that in, because it's very steep up to the hole. So factor the fact that you're going into the wind, uphill, quite a slope there.
Yes, sir. We're lucky today, it's just a gentle breeze. But it is uphill. Well, I got a visual on this. No, not a good putt. Well, the putt wasn't so bad, I just misread it.
Okay, Peter, I know, and we can now see that was a very, very steep putt up the hill here. Now, that greens are enormous width here and length here, and there's a lot of territory between that particular putt and this hole, and you can see the slope looking back down there as well.
It was very slow up there.
Yeah, very slow. I'd like to discuss something.
Very fast this way.
Fast this way, slow up the hill because it's very steep. I'd like to discuss something with you, and we can come back down here, Peter, and let's just have a talk about this first putt. And something I talk to my students about here at Moona Links all the time. A lady here just recently who was a very, very poor putter, and I brought her out here to this very green, and we put her in about the same place here, and I asked her to have a practice putt as if she was going to go up that hole, and this was her practice stroke. So then I moved to 10 foot closer to the hole and asked her what her stroke, practice stroke was like. And then I moved to 10 foot closer, and it was the same practice stroke every time. And I said to her, well, how do you determine how far you want to go? And she was saying, I use my feet as a guide. how far the club's going. So I said, that's fine, that's terrific. Well, let's put your feet wider and make the putter go the width of your feet. And the minute she did that, had her feet wider, the first thing that happened, she got a ball up to the hole. So her theory was correct, but her technique hadn't adjusted to the longer putt. So what I'd like to see you do, Peter, why don't you give that a try for the camera and see what happens if you have your feet wider and make a longer stroke. Let's see what happens. See if it works.
Okay, it sounds pretty plausible. Let's see what we do. Wider stance for a longer putt.
That's a terrific putt. Oh, I'll send you the bill.
Okay. That was well done. Thanks very much, Phil. Look, the first part I mishit it a bit, but it was definitely learning by trial and error.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people just go on, they don't come back and practice that putt when they're out here by themselves. Yeah. I think you can learn a lot going back and re-practicing.
Indeed. I'm going to now go back to the edge of the green here, which is a typical putt we see with a lot of players under-clubbing with that back pin. Now, you and I both played 7-irons in to only about a 130-yard shot, wasn't it?
That's
Whereas
right.
The average player probably would look at that and say, well, it's a 9-iron. Now, as you turn around and look at this green here, the false front, anything short here rolls back down the bottom.
If I just roll that ball, just watch what happens.
It's most likely going to go rolled off, and not only that, it'll pick up a bit of speed, and it's not even dry today, and that ball could roll back. I've seen it in the tournament conditions roll back 30 or 40 metres. So now we've got a putt up there. Now the camera probably won't even pick it up, Peter. It's so far up there. But we're going to look
those two balls
between those two golf balls. So what I'm going to do now, we'll see if that theory worked with the wide feet. Now, of course, the good thing about having the wide feet, I look a bit like a tripod now. And of course, if you've got a camera on top of the tripod, the camera's not going to move. It actually helps to stay very stable over the ball. So what I'm going to do is stay very still, much longer stroke, and you'll see the ball will get up to the hole quite comfortably. And most players never get the ball that far with their putts because they don't swing it long enough.
Very good lesson. Fantastic. Thank you.
Something different for Moon Links.
Well, we're down here on the academy. This used to be the Australian Institute of Sport coaching academy for their elite players. And this is one of the nice practice tee here.
Mm.
And when you get set up for schools, you have goalposts and everything out there, don't you?
Three tees we've got here, Peter, and the best thing about it, the Santa Ana Cooch grass, which is really well maintained. I've got this teaching tee here, the bottom teaching tee, which also doubles as a pitching area, so we can pitch from here down to that tee at 30 yards, which is a great shot for people to practice keeping their foot down, and that area there. And I've also got a teaching pod up in another area up there, so I can have coaches coaching here. We can go up there, we don't even hear each other. Now the best part about it is that we have five targets here. We've got the four different bunkers up there and the green. So it's 165 yards to the middle of that green. It's a great target. And then we have unlimited distance how far we can hit our drivers up the end of the fairway. So why don't we go over and have a look at our 18-hole putting green and our beautifully designed pitching green, which has three bunkers there as well for specialist shots.
Can I ask, there's a garage door here, what's that all about?
Well, that's my indoor teaching bay, so if it rains, no matter what the conditions are, we pull that roller door up, and I've got a teaching mat up there, properly set up as most driving ranges have, so even in wet weather, we can still operate.
Now, I see alongside some bicycles, what are those bicycles doing in there?
Well, that's in our gymnasium, it has a full set of weights up there, free weights, bicycles, rowing machine. It has resistance machines, it has free weights, barbells, balls, bounce balls, Swiss balls. It's a fully equipped gymnasium.
Now, a man called Ramsay McMaster, he is very famous. Unfortunately, he passed away just a couple of years back.
Mm.
But he was very instrumental in helping set up the physical training for golf, wasn't it?
Very much so, Peter. He was the physiotherapist here. In fact, the physiotherapy room is still here. And Ramsay was a terrific fella. Lucky enough to meet Ramsay, and I used him myself as my physiotherapist on many occasions, and he was instrumental in driving force between a lot of the guys that are out playing the tour these days. We also have a big conference room in there where we can set up, if we've got a group of 16 to 20 students with a whiteboard, we can set up as a classroom, which is really good.
It is fantastic. We just did a school here just last week.
Okay.
And
Great.
We're out here thanks to your management here.
Well, I'm sure they enjoyed it. I'm sure all your students enjoyed it. I enjoy it. Beautiful Moona trees around here. The area is quiet. It's really quiet. We've got no traffic going by here, so people aren't getting distracted. So it's a really nice area for golfers to come and learn golf. It's a great environment. And as we pan out towards our putting green here, it's a beautifully maintained putting green. We usually keep 9 holes in it, but we can put more holes in it if it's needed. It's maintained the same pace as the golf course, so you're actually replicating the putting stroke you're using here. We're using out in the golf course as well. To the left you'll see the teaching pod, which gives us a nice little 80 yard shot down towards that chipping green I showed you earlier. And even if you walk up on the hill here, Peter, the fescue grass, the rough around the putting green here, it's the same as on the course. And the fescue grass on this little hill here, which I can teach my students to practice out of, that very deep wiry lie, this is where those sand dynes come into play. So we can actually do some practice out of here as well. So the golfers get an all-round experience when they come here to Moona Links Golf Academy.
Well, just when I came here last week with a school, and you made me most welcome. It was great, and we can use your services when we get a big enough number.
Of course.
I think you're very welcoming. You'd like people from around the world, like golf pros, to bring their groups here?
Oh, of course. I mean, they'd be most welcome here. When they come here, the best part about it is your students have this whole facility themselves. No one else will be here. If we bring a group in, it'll be just them. The pitching green down there, you can't see from here. The green there has nice slopes on it, has little areas for chipping and run shots, for pitch shots, and has 3 different bunkers with different depths, and we can use different sand in those bunkers as well, depending on who's coming out here. So the students coming out will not only know how to play these golf courses, but all the golf courses on this peninsula, which is great. And we've got the facility to be able to get them on all those golf courses. We've got the National Golf Club, number 8, and the Moona course is rated number 8 in Australia. The Old Course is rated number 10. Most of the courses in this Moorea Peninsula are rated, you know, somewhere near the top 100 of golf courses around the country, which is brilliant.
Yeah, you've got Sorrento Golf Club, Portsea, Eagle Ridge.
The Dunes, of course.
The Dunes is fantastic.
Yeah, Flinders is a great little golf course. Peter Thompson used to practice supposedly before he went to the British Open because of the winds over there. It's by the sea. It's a great vista. It's another great little golf course. You've got Rosebud Country Club, which has their own accommodation there.
And the public course.
And Rosebud Public Golf Course, which is fantastic. And, of course, Cape Shank, owned by the RACV, which is a Trent Jones Jr. designed golf course. It's like a little old little golf course, like the old golf course, but not quite on the steroids.
Yeah, exactly. Now the nice thing is if a group does come in here and brings a school in, playing lessons, like you specialise in out in the golf course, don't you?
Yeah, we take them out in the course and we teach them how to, what you saw what we're doing out there today, we take them out in the course and get them to understand the courses down here, how to play the wind. We love it when the wind blows down here because most golfers don't ever experience the wind that we get. I was showing some students the other day how to play 100-yard 3-on-4 irons because that's how strong the wind is. If a pitching wedge normally goes 100 yards, when you've got a 70 or 80 kilometre hour wind, what club would you use?
But it's not like that. It's a beautiful place to come.
It's not that windy
all the time.
No, it's not like Pebble Beach or any of those other courses.
Well, this is an exceptionally good day, but it's just a gentle breeze. So, and I love it here. I think for 7-8 months of the year, this is a great place to. It's a great place to play golf and live.
Yeah, it certainly is, and particularly if you want to get away from that North American winter.
Yeah, or the heat of the tropics in the summer, because even though it's so warm here, it's not a humidity.
It's a very, very nice place to be. Look, I welcome all you guys to come down to PGA Professionals and other golfers to come to the Moorea Peninsula. You'll really love it. Thanks for coming out today, Peter. Glad to have you both out here.
Thanks, Phil, and we look forward to coming back, and we're going to bring a school back here in April.
Love to have you
here.
Okay, see you all.